Hi, I'm Lindsay Stringer. I'm Professor in Environment and Development in the Department of Environment and Geography. And today I'm going to be talking to you about two cows, 20 chickens and 50 kilograms of maize and how I celebrated my research impact in style. Tucked away among the hills and surrounded mostly by South Africa, but with Mozambique to the east, is the kingdom of Eswatini, the country formerly known as Swaziland. Today, I want to take you on a journey to Eswatini and to share my experiences in doing research there and disseminating the findings. In doing so, I'm also going to be taking you on a journey back in time to when I was a young postgraduate student. During my PhD in the early 2000s, my research focused on understanding the main forms of land degradation in Eswatini and how different local understandings and perspectives on it were being incorporated into policy. But with limited PhD funding, as is often the case, I didn't get the chance to go back to share my findings with the people who could benefit directly from my research. And that was a real regret. Now, if we fast forward to 2015, I was lucky enough to be awarded a Philip Leverhulme Prize, which is an incredibly flexible fund. And you can use it for pretty much any research that's legal. And this was my chance, really, to return to Eswatini and revisit what I'd done for my PhD 10 years on to get a longer term view on land degradation, but also to finally be able to share my results with the people that could use them. Now, as is the case in most of Africa, land degradation in Eswatini is quite a critical challenge. You've got a lot of small scale farmers who are often too poor to be able to afford the necessary fertilizers to maintain the soil quality on their land. And if you combine that with a hilly landscape, climate change impacts where you're getting more extreme rainfall events, this can lead to some quite severe erosion and gullies form. Basically, everything just gets washed down the slope and it really damages the land. Now, most of the country's just over 1 million people live in the central part of the country known as the Middelveld. And that's where my research took place as well. 70% of the country's population depend on agriculture to make a living and to survive. So obviously any decline in the quality of the land and the yields as a knock-on effect can really have quite profound effects on people's lives. At the global scale, the major international framework for addressing issues with land is the UN Convention to Combat Desertification, or the UNCCD as it's known. Although the UNCCD has been around a while, it was developed back in 1994, even then we knew that to be able to tackle the issue of land degradation, local people need to be involved as part of the solution and that they hold local knowledge that's really valuable that can help inform how the land is managed. Now, as researchers, we like to think that we're the ones that should be defining the problem and identifying the solutions. But for the research insights to really reach those people who can use them and put them into practice, and so they don't just sit there and gather dust on a shelf, it requires particular kinds of research and approaches that involve the land users from the outset and which use appropriate methods to share the findings with them. So when I went back to Eswatini through the Philip Leverhulme Prize money, I sought to address this kind of challenge. The return visits together with a postdoc used the same methods and approaches that I'd used originally, working in the same places, and surprisingly little had changed in terms of where the people were. I could even involve the same respondents. My original findings had highlighted problems of soil erosion, parasitic weed infestations, and also declines in soil fertility. And people were saying, yeah, they're affecting our crop yields, particularly of maize, which is the major staple crop that most households in Swaziland grow. In returning, we wanted to know how land users were identifying and responding to degradation and whether what they were doing was enough to be able to really improve the condition of the land. I was actually quite nervous about going back. I wasn't sure, you know, would people remember? Would they be cross that I'd not been back before? Were they even gonna be willing to talk to me? I also didn't really know how it was gonna work, how I could really share the results in a way that was meaningful to the local people. I was expecting perhaps we'd get permission from the chief to do some more data collection, and then maybe afterwards, once the analysis was done, maybe we'd hold a small workshop with some traditional leaders who would then go back and tell the villagers about the findings. So I was a bit taken aback when I asked the chief, you know, how should we do this? And the answer to my question came as, we need to celebrate the research in our traditional way. We can have food and hold an event that is memorable for everyone. Now, there were 90 households in the village, and we'd spoken with all of them during the research. So after collecting the data from the second round, we went back to the UK to analyse it, and we had to make contact with the villagers via those people that could get into town and get internet access so that we could work with them to plan the dissemination event. And I've been thinking, we've got 90 households, we can invite one adult from each household. So yeah, it's quite a reasonable sized event, 90 people. But with the bit of back and forth over email, it soon became obvious that the expectation wasn't to invite 90 people. It was actually to invite everyone in the village, kids and all. And that amounted to an estimated 1,500 people. So yeah, my contacts in the village who managed to get the somewhat irregular internet access sent us various instructions as to how to proceed, as you can see on the slide with the shopping list that they've provided. Everyone was excited about the event and got fully engaged, and they provided more and more details about the proposed programme as we got closer to the day of the celebration. A local events committee had been established, there was a catering committee, a decorations committee, and school children rehearsed songs and dances as well. The villagers themselves had offered to provide some of the maize that we needed, and given that they had grown it themselves, I was a bit, do I allow this? You know, can they contribute in this way? So I sought some cultural advice, and yeah, on the basis of that, I gratefully accepted their offer. So, you know, between us, we were all contributing something. My major concern was actually how I was going to source, slaughter and store two cows. And also how I was going to get a receipt that simply said cows too through the university finance office. So you can imagine I was pretty relieved by the time I got back, went back there, and the cow situation had already been sorted out. And after lots of shopping, trips to the wholesalers and village meetings the day before the celebration, alongside a bit of firewood and water collection, a really early start was needed on the day of the celebration. The women in the catering committee had been up since sunrise, boiling water, cooking chickens and beef, peeling veg and generally preparing absolutely everything. When we arrived, the decorations were up and we added some posters as well that summarised the main findings of the research in both English and Siswati. The posters also had some drawings on of the major kind of good land management practices that the villagers were using. And we strategically positioned them near where people were going to be queuing for their food so that everybody would have a chance to have a look and have a read. Once everyone had arrived, the party started, and the local pastor gave an opening prayer through a loud hailer. That was the best way to reach that kind of number of people, we decided. And then the nominated MC announced that we were there to celebrate the information that the villagers had provided about the land and to discuss some good examples of how they're managing it. I was up next. I thanked everyone and gave the headline research findings, and a master's student from the University of Eswatini translated everything into Siswati and then talked through the posters with everybody. One of the main challenges that repeatedly came up in the research was that people felt they didn't know about the opportunities available to help them manage their land more sustainably from beyond the village. And in the lead up to the party, we'd paid the local agricultural extension officer a visit. And he had said, actually, I rarely get to visit that community due to a lack of resources. I've got a motorbike, but no fuel. He said, I've actually got some important news for them as well. So we invited him to come along to the party. We picked him up on the way, and he was up next in the programme. And he was able to tell everybody about free soil testing and the maize and fertiliser subsidies that were newly available at the time for people to apply for. After that came the singing and dancing. We had girls in traditional dress singing a new song they'd written about people from the UK who came to the village to discuss farming. Then the boys did some traditional dancing. And after that was some more singing and dancing by the village men and by the women's group as well. Finally came the food. Everyone seemed thrilled with the food, the meat especially. People mingled as they waited for their portions, chatting and laughing and generally asking questions about the posters. So what was the outcome of all this effort and the sacrifice of the two cows who bravely gave up their lives for this celebration? Well, there was an excited buzz all day, and everyone we spoke to was delighted about the party. Some people told us it provided a nice way to bring the community together. Other people said, well, actually, you know, we don't normally eat meat, we can't afford it, so it was just nice to eat meat. Whatever the reason was, people seemed satisfied that they'd enjoyed a nice day out and that they had learned something about good land management practices in the process. Compared to other research approaches, the celebration gave people a chance to develop much more of a sense of ownership over the research dissemination than is usual, as well as allowing me to tap into their local knowledge throughout the whole process. The dissemination event had been created by the land users themselves, the people who could benefit from the research. So overall, the approach that was taken was contextually appropriate, and it took into account the social and the cultural aspects that were important in the village. Taking the agricultural extension officer along as well provided a kind of Brucey bonus for change and impact too. So not part of the research necessarily, but another opportunity to bring about change. The whole experience really highlights the value of building relationships with the people the research is designed to benefit, as opposed to just helicoptering in and leaving never to return, which is so often the way it is, particularly in environmental research these days. All the participatory aspects I've outlined here kind of come together to help create a research context that shows that by building relationships, it can really help to amplify research impact. As research funders increasingly want to show value for public money in terms of research outcomes and benefits to society, the experience that I presented shows that these kind of approaches can help to achieve that goal. But the way that the research funding works more generally still seems quite geared every time towards doing something new, not necessarily revisiting the old. And it's still quite short term, really. We don't look enough at how things change over time, and we don't do enough longitudinal work either to identify which kinds of approaches can best deliver impact. Now, the kind of approach I've outlined, it isn't just relevant in tackling land degradation problems. We can use it for other environmental issues as well, things like climate change adaptation, biodiversity loss, water quality, for example, as well as other areas outside of environmental science, things like finance, education, and health. And these global challenges, they play out everywhere, but they're really experienced at a local level. So this shows the importance of engaging with people on the ground at the local level to really capture the diversity of experiences and to share the lessons with them from people and to share the lessons from them with people suffering similar challenges in other places. Now, while celebrating the research in this kind of way isn't going to be appropriate in all contexts, I hope that I've managed to stimulate some new ideas as to how we can actually harness research impact. Of course, the question remains as to whether people are still using or have taken up any of the good land management practices that we shared with them at the party. But obviously I need research money to do that. So if anyone wants to give me some more flexible funding, I'd love to go back and see what's going on, go back to Eswatini, measure the uptake and the current state of sustainable land management. And I think I'd do it again. I would definitely hold another celebration as everybody had such a nice time in learning about the research. Thanks very much.